Hi, welcome to this video. We will be talking about methods for describing data sets. We'll start by talking about the measures of center. For the measures of center, we have the sample mean, which is computed by summation xi over n, and the population mean mu, which is computed by summation xi over capital N. We have the median, which is obtained first by sorting our data values. If n, the sample size, is odd, the median is the middle number. If n is even, the median is the average of the two numbers that fall at the middle. The mode of our data set is the value or values that occur with the greatest frequency. Then we have our measures of variability. We have the range, which is simply the maximum value in our data set minus the minimum value. We have the sample variance, S squared, which is the summation of X minus X bar squared divided by N minus 1. The sample standard deviation is simply the square root of the sample variance. The population variance is computed by taking the sum of xi minus the population mean squared divided by capital N. The population standard deviation is simply the square root of the population variance. Then we have the coefficient of variation. For the population, we compute the coefficient of variation by taking the population standard deviation divided by the population mean, and we multiply by 100 to write it as a percentage. For the sample, we compute the coefficient of variation by taking the sample standard deviation divided by the sample mean multiplied by 100. Next, we look at the following example. A student recorded how much she spent on groceries during the first 7 weeks of the fall semester. So we have the values recorded here. We're supposed to compute the following values: the mean, the median, the mode, the range, the variance, the standard deviation, and the coefficient of variation. We are simply going to be using Excel to compute these values. Once we have our values in Excel, I'm going to be using data analysis. But before I do that, I will show you how to compute a few of those values. To find a population standard deviation, we keep in mind that this data is from a sample. But assuming it was from a population and we wanted to find the population standard deviation, we would go to any cell and type equal to STDEV.P. So this will be the standard deviation for a population. If the data was from a population, we'll highlight the whole column containing the data and then we hit return. If you wanted to find the variance, we can either square that or we can go to any cell and type equal to VAR.P. And then we highlight the column of data. And then we also hit the enter button. But now I'm going to be using the data analysis add-in in Excel to find all of my summary statistics. So I'll go to data analysis, and on this list, I'll look for descriptive statistics and then click OK. I'm going to input my data range. Again, this is assuming the data is from a sample. And then I'm going to check the box that says summary statistics and click OK. Right away, all of my summary statistics shows up. So I have my mean here. I have my median. It's given here. I have my mode. For Excel, it would typically return for me the smallest value among the modes when I use data analysis. I have my standard deviation right here. I have my sample variance right there. I have my range right here. and you know, the minimum and the maximum value. So this right here returns for me my summary statistics. The only other value that we want to find is the coefficient of variation. Again, this will be for the sample. So I'm going to go to any cell and type equal to. I'm going to take the standard deviation and divide by the sample mean. If I want, I can multiply by 100 to write it as a percentage, and that returns for me the coefficient of variation. Next, I will be talking about the empirical rule. For the empirical rule, it's valid if my data distribution is bell-shaped, symmetrical, and unimodal. The empirical rule says approximately 68% of the data will lie within one standard deviation of the mean. Approximately 95% of the data will lie within two standard deviations of the mean. And approximately 99.7% of the data will lie within three standard deviations of the mean. This will be true for both population and sample data. We can see here that our data is symmetrical and the mean is at the center. Again, it could be a sample mean or a population mean. Here we're focusing on the sample. So at the center right there, we have the sample mean. So when we move one standard deviation above and below, we have approximately 68% of the data within one standard deviation of the mean. And then within two standard deviations of the mean, we have approximately 95%. Within three standard deviations of the mean, we have approximately 99.7%. Again, we think about the fact that our distribution is symmetrical. So when we cut across the middle, we have approximately 50% of the data on either side. When we also look at using the property of symmetry, within one standard deviation of the mean, we have 68%. So on either side of the mean, we have 68 divided by 2, which gives us 34%, you know, from the mean to each standard deviation above and below. We use the similar approach. Two standard deviations away is 95%. So from the center to two standard deviations above and from the center to two standard deviations below, we can cut that in half, and either side by symmetry, we have 47.5%. If we repeat the same for three standard deviations away from the mean, by symmetry, from the center to each of those points, we have approximately 48.95%. So now that we have divided up our distribution, we can see the smaller segments can be obtained based on the way we have divided up the segments. And when we fill in all of the values, we have those pieces. Now, the little piece that we have left on both tails is approximately 0.3%. So by symmetry, again, on either tail, we have approximately 0.15%. Now, let's use empirical rule to answer this question. The sample mean X bar for a data set is 30 with a standard deviation of S equals to 5. So if we look at the distribution at the center, which is the mean, we have 30. So if we go one standard deviation to the right, 35, another standard deviation, 40, another one, 45. And then below or to the left, we have 25 and then 20 and then 15. So now we can actually be able to use, based on the way we have divided this up into segments, we can be able to use that to answer any question that we need, to be able to find the area between two points, above a point, or below a point. For example, if we're asked approximately what percent of the scores is above 30, we're going to come right here and locate 30. So above to the right will be everything from the center above it. So in that case, it will be approximately 50%. If we have, we want to know the area between 20 and 40, we will locate 20 and then 40. We'll see right away that that is within two standard deviations. So that will be approximately 95%. And if we ask what percent of the score is between 30 and 35, again, we locate that piece in our picture here, we'll see that will be approximately 34%. Next, we'll be talking about measures of position, which involves dividing our data into equivalent subgroups. Now, the data we're going to be looking at in this case will be ungrouped data. Now, for the ungrouped data, this will be data that are collected in the raw form, and it could be an array of numbers. So for the measures of position, we can think about different ways in which we can cut up our data. We can talk about quartiles, which involves cutting our data into four equal parts. Deciles, which involves cutting our data into 10 parts. And percentiles, which involves cutting our data into approximately 100 parts. If we look at our quartiles, it's dividing our data into four equal parts. So we see that we have approximately 25% on each area we have there. And it has been divided. And before we can do that, the data must have been arranged in ascending order. So for example, my Q1 here will be a point that has approximately 25% of the data below it and approximately 75% of the data above it. My Q1 here is referred to as the lower quartile or the first quartile. My Q2 is referred to as the middle quartile or the second quartile, while my Q3 is referred to as the upper quartile or the third quartile. Look at an example we have here. The following are the salaries of 11 high-performing account managers at a Toronto firm in thousands of dollars. So we have the values listed here. So we want to determine the quartiles for these salaries, that is Q1, Q2, and Q3. And we want to understand what they mean by interpreting them. So I'm just going to quickly again show you how to use a formula in Excel to obtain this. Once we have our data in Excel, we go to any cell and we type equal to quartile, it's going to show up. I'm going to use that very first one, quartile.exc. And then I'm going to highlight the whole column and put a comma. So right here, if I want the value in the first quartile or the 25th percentile, I'll put a 1. It returns for me that value, which in this case is 72. If I wanted the value in the second quartile, I'm going to repeat the same, only this time I will be putting a 2 and it's going to return for me the value in the second quartile. And of course, we can repeat the same to be able to find the value in the third quartile. Based on the results we got from Excel, we can see that the value, the Q1, will be the value in the first quartile, which means that about 25% of the salaries is below $72,000 and about 75% is above $72,000. If we repeat using the same formula, we are going to get 77, the value in the second quartile. We can interpret similarly and say about 50% of the salaries is below $77,000 and about 50% is above $77,000. And lastly, for Q3, we can say that about 75% of the salaries is below $85,000. The remaining 25% is above it. Thank you for watching this video.